Joining us now on the line from Princeton, New Jersey, Orley Ashenfelter. He is an economist at Princeton University. And Orley, it's good of you to join us on TVO tonight. How are you doing?
My pleasure.
I want to start by reading, glad to hear that. I want to start by reading an excerpt from Tom Friedman's book, The Lexus and the Olive Tree, that will get us into this discussion about the importance of McDonald's. Every once in a while, when I'm traveling abroad, he writes, I need to indulge in a burger and a bag of McDonald's French fries. For all I know, I have eaten McDonald's burgers and fries in more countries of the world than anyone, and I can testify that they all really do taste the same. Now, whether they do or they don't all taste the same, there is something about using McDonald's to explain how the world works. You know the old expression, no two countries that have McDonald's have ever gone to war against each other. And The Economist magazine, back in 1986, used what they called the Big Mac Index to explain purchasing power parity. And we're going to put that graphic up right now of the Big Mac Index. And while we put that up, perhaps you could explain to us why you believe it's such a useful benchmark for economists to use.
The prices that they use are fascinating, and largely because, and I think this is why The Economist picked it, there are very few countries in the world where exactly the same product is produced using the exact same methods. The Big Mac is one. And their concept, of course, was that it would tell you something about exchange rates. In other words, once you adjust for exchange rates, their concept, what purchasing power parity says, that the price of Big Mac should be the same everywhere. This, of course, is not true. And the reason it's not true is because of the fact that there are both tradable and non-tradable goods. Big Mac is a sort of in-between. About half of what goes into a Big Mac comes from other places, and about half is local labor. So what we've discovered is it's a useful way to think about exchange rates for countries that are at the same levels of development. But if you want to compare countries at different levels of development, you have to think harder about how to do it.
Which explains why Switzerland is doing so well on the Big Mac Index and why China and India are not doing as well. That gives you a good yardstick, if you will.
Switzerland is a good example. A worker at a McDonald's makes $22 an hour, but of course a Big Mac costs $7.50. So it turns out you get about 3 Big Macs per hour of work in Switzerland, which is not much different from what you get in Canada. It's just that in that particular case, it's clear their exchange rate is really mucked up.
In your paper, you compare real wages in Canton Province, China, today to London, England, during and after the Industrial Revolution. What's the point of doing that?
Well, I start with that comparison. Canton is where Hong Kong is, by the way. I had discovered this by doing some research on what people have done in the history of real wages. A real wage rate is just how much you can buy with an hour of your work. And there have now been economic historians who have put a lot of effort into measuring real wage rates all the way as far back as Roman times. And what seems to be the case is that up until about 1800, real wage rates were just a little above subsistence all over the world. So the real wage rate, shocking as it may seem, in Hong Kong in 1700 was about the same as it was in London. By 1914, that's just before the start of the First World War, real wage rates in London were about 6 or 7 times what they were in China. Starting in around 1800, the world just opened up. Some countries went through an industrial revolution, and it became far wealthier than others, and some did not go through those revolutions. In fact, the vast majority of the world did not. And so they're at just abjectly lower levels of income, even today, compared to the developed countries.
Let me follow up on this Big Mac Index as well, because you've used it in a slightly different way. You've used it to examine wages as opposed to purchasing power. Can you explain your approach?
Yes. So the basic idea is that actually, it started in India. I was with a friend, and they always argue there about what reform does, and you know, has it helped the economy? And they're a terrific, open, wonderful, exotic country, democracy, freedom of the press, the whole thing. And so I asked him, well, what does someone in a McDonald's? Do you have a McDonald's? Yes, we do. What do they make there? And he said, I don't know. So we went off to a McDonald's, and I had a Big Mac, and I always have a chocolate shake and a fry. And I found out what they cost, and then I asked the worker right there. They didn't mind telling me how much they made. The idea was then I suddenly saw that basically the worker made about 15 rupees an hour, and the Big Mac cost about 45 rupees. That was a little over a dollar. So it turned out, I realized suddenly on that spot, here was a worker doing exactly the same thing as a worker in a developed country and making only enough money to be able to hour 20 minutes the way you would in North America. And suddenly I thought, you know, McDonald's exists almost everywhere. What I should really try to do is to fill up a hole that we have in economic statistics for the world. And the hole is we don't really know what's happened to wage rates as the countries that are now starting to develop pretty rapidly do develop. And most Americans especially, I think, are unaware of the fact that even though a country is growing, there's an enormous gap between where most countries are and where we are.
Now, having looked at so many different countries, were you able to come to a conclusion about what, in your mind, would be, I don't know, the fairest amount of time one would have to work in order to be able to afford a Big Mac? You said in India you got to work 3 hours, some places 20 minutes. What's a reasonable middle ground?
Well, actually, there is no such thing as a fair wage. The wage rates that you can get paid in the country you're in really depend on the productivity in that country, overall aggregate productivity. And the message that I try to portray is that by measuring what a worker makes at a McDonald's, you're just measuring the wage rate that people are getting in the country as a whole. And by doing that, we actually get a measure not only of how well off they are, but also how productive the country is. And when it changes, when wages grow, typically that's because of growth in productivity, and that's a way to measure that without having to go to a lot of trouble. So that's I think it can't really talk about a fair wage. You know, my view is the workers should always get as much as they can possibly get, but what they can possibly get depends heavily on how productive their society is.
Let's bring up a few charts then as we continue our conversation, and you can help us through these to understand what you're trying to say in your paper on this. This one is in your paper, figure four. It's called the McWage Ratio. And as we look in the bottom left-hand corner of the graph, we can see places like the Philippines, Mexico, Brazil, moving along Singapore, Korea, Israel, and then in the top right corner, some of the wealthier countries of the world, Switzerland, Denmark, and Norway. What are you trying to say with this graph?
That's a busy graph, but I think it's well labeled, and if you think about it for a minute, I think you'll be able to get a lot of information from it. First of all, I've expressed everything on there relative to the U.S., to the USA. So you'll see there's a point USA. That's at the point 1-1. Basically, that's the center of that graph. And the idea is to draw the line, 45-degree line, and on one axis is the wage rate a person gets at a McDonald's, all measured in dollars compared to the U.S., and then what the BLS thinks the wage rate is for someone in manufacturing relative to the U.S.
BLS meaning?
Bureau of Labor Statistics, the United States. Yeah, the United States Bureau of Labor Statistics still has, although there's some question about how long it'll last, a collection system for collecting some data on wage rates in manufacturing in countries that I imagine they think are competitors of the U.S. So they're a good source of data. They don't have it for so many countries, but they have it for some. The key to that graph is if you're on the line, you're just like the U.S. If you're further out on the line from the U.S., then you're at a higher level of development. So you can see if you go out there, you see Germany, even Canada. You learn two lessons from this. First of all, the wage rate that people are paid at McDonald's is highly correlated with the wage rate that people receive in manufacturing. They're not the same, but they're highly correlated. The second lesson you learn that's very important for Americans is the U.S. is no longer a high-wage country. Amongst the developed countries, both in terms of the wage rate at a McDonald's as well as the wage rate in manufacturing, the vaunted Germany, for example, those wage rates are higher than they are in the United States. So you learn both of those lessons from that graph.
Let's continue our look at what working at McDonald's tells us about wages internationally. Figure 10 in your paper is a bar graph on the percentage of growth in McWages between the years 2000 and 2007. And we can see, as per your point just made, the U.S. has had almost no growth whatsoever, Canada a little bit more, but Russia, that bar goes well up the top of the chart. What else does this graph tell us?
That chart really is one of the great pieces of optimism of the 21st century. The fact that Russia, by the way, is something of an exception. They went through a really nasty depression in about 1999, And so some of what you're seeing there is a recovery from that really nasty depression. But China and India are good examples that are not affected by a recession. You see the very rapid growth there. That's the most rapid growth they've ever had, probably in the history of their entire countries. So that is a time when it appears that, for the first time, these developing countries are starting to catch up with the developed countries. The developed countries moved away from the other countries starting in the 19th century and kept far away in the 20th century, and maybe we're finally going to see the poverty that half the world has to suffer start to decline.
Hmm. Orley, let's do one more chart here, and for this one, it's figure 15 in your paper, the percentage growth in Big Macs per hour of work, again for the years 2007 to 2011. And in this one, we've got Russia and China, again, going through the wall here, or going through the ceiling, I guess, and places like South Africa and Japan, well below the line. What's significant about this chart? Mm-hmm.
Well, the reason I chose those dates is because 2000 is when I started collecting these data, and 2007 was at a point where I was collecting data for a lot of countries. And so that was, I took 2007 to be sort of a normal time. And the period from 2007 to 2011, of course, is the world's financial crisis. The message that comes out of that is that the growth that we saw from 2000 to 2007 in quite a bit of the world has mostly come to a halt. The exceptions, as you say, are China and Russia. Even India has now not grown at the same rate as it was growing. So the I highlighted that so that people could see that what's gone on here is a real setback in terms of what had happened during the previous decade for most of the world, not all of it.
Now, given all of this information that you've accumulated and put in these graphics so that we can better understand what you've accumulated, and having analyzed the data, are you prepared to make any predictions about wage growths going forward and in what part of the world?
Boy, that is a great question. I no. The answer is no. I don't know what's going to happen. It is tempting to think that China will continue to grow at a rapid rate. It's very important to understand how low the wage rates are there. I mean, in 2007, they were making 85 cents an hour. It's doubled since then, but they're still making far less than what would be made in the United States or Canada. So they have a very, very long way to go. I think everyone's optimistic that things will go well in both China and India, but you never know for sure what will happen. And there have been aberrations where, if you have an unstable government, everyone suddenly falls back in a way that you wouldn't like very much. I think that, so that's where the thing is, the developing countries have, in potential, a huge advantage. All they have to do is imitate the developed countries. Just adopt the policies that the developed countries have, and they're on their way toward making, you know, getting an enormous amount of progress. The developed countries have a much, much more difficult problem. In order for developed countries to have real wage growth, generally speaking, there are only two ways to get it. One is you can change shares. In other words, you could take away money from capital. That doesn't usually work for very long. And the other possibility is aggregate output can grow, productivity can grow. What we really need is for productivity to grow. If productivity were to grow in the developed countries, I think we would see real wage growth. The difficulty is that in order for us to grow in the developed countries, we really need to expand technology. We have to invent new things. And those things have to be productive enough so that they actually create additional demand for workers and then show up in advantages that workers and the country itself receive. So I'm not, I would say optimism right now is pretty hard to find. The most we can hope for is to make sure that we stay out of recession. As for long-term growth, I just don't know what's going to happen.
Are you yet sick of eating Big Macs, chocolate shakes, and fries?
You know, I very, very rarely eat those. However, there is no doubt that they are outstanding products. And one of the great things about them, and the reason Thomas Friedman likes to eat them all over the world, is that you never get sick, no matter where you have one. The food safety associated with McDonald's is really terrific. And I learned that starting in the 1950s when we'd drive across the U.S. But I think the products are terrific. What can I say? Maybe not the healthiest thing for someone my age to be eating.
Well, the fact is they do taste good. Orley Ashenfelter, it's good of you to join us on the line from Princeton University. Thanks so much.
My pleasure.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.